I'm really excited to start this because with me I have leaders who have built community, not just for a cause, not just for a product, but for services as well. And we all know that we as human beings, we are social. Right from the beginning of the day we formed a tribe, the community had started. I mean, the community, the process for community started right then. But then as businesses came up, what we did was we looked at community only to build loyal customers. But then now we are in a state wherein we have products such as Walnut app or Eco, which transforms a human being into an ATM. And without even making any effort, they are building a community and they are crowdsourcing information through the community. And that's exactly what is driving the product. So right from being social to using community for their business or for marketing, essentially, to build the entire product around a community, we have come a long way. With me, I would wish to start with Ms. Revathi Roy, very proud to speak to her. She is one of the top trailblazers by Forbes this month, if you have seen the magazine. Very proud to talk to her, really proud of you. Yes, please. A big round of applause for her, for all that she has done. So, yes, Ms. Roy, why did you start Deedee? Why did you choose that product out of so many things to choose? Why exactly that?
So, okay, Deedee is my third venture. Well, I started with 2007, I started with my first all-women cab service, which was for She, and then my second brand was Vera. So it's after 10 years that I've now started the third brand. And so at a time when it started in 2007, there was really no concept of a commercial taxi, women taxi driver. So now you can think of women as cab drivers. So when way back that time, I started the service by becoming a taxi driver myself. So I actually drove a cab for 10 months in Bombay and then created this whole community of hundreds of other cab drivers. Deedee now is a community of girls who are here to do the last mile delivery service on two-wheelers. So with e-commerce growing the way it is, the last mile delivery is always going to be done by a human being. It's never going to be a robot. It's a no-brainer that this is a community which would be the most sought after in the e-commerce industry. So I thought there was a niche and a gap to be filled up. So I created this community. I'm in the process of creating, and we already have about today, we have about 2,800 girls under training and about 100-150 girls already doing last mile delivery. So next time, they're located to certain areas right now because the number is small. But anybody south of Bandra, if you order a Domino's or a Pizza Hut or a Subway or McDonald's or any of these, you may get a Deedee to deliver it to your house. So that's what we do.
Lovely. Okay. Just to add, yeah, this is a lovely idea. I don't know whether you have seen, there's an ad on YouTube wherein a lady is returning home late at night and she's talking to her dad, and her dad constantly worries that, why are you returning alone? Give me the cab number. Give the phone to the cab driver. And suddenly the lady passes the phone to the driver, and the driver is a lady. And she says, "Dariye mat uncle, main aapki beti ko sahi se ghar pahuncha dungi." So the message of the ad is, when we have more and more women working in the world, we will have a safer world. So I have no words to the concept that you've started with Deedee, because there are a lot of areas wherein people stay alone, right? The societies are not safe. These deliveries are not exactly safe. So if you have started this, it's quite a brave measure, right?
Yeah, so just to, you know, put a context in place, I think about 2 months or 3 months back, you must have read Bangalore, there was this molestation cases. Yes. You'll be surprised to know that the molestation cases in Bangalore, all three molestation cases were by delivery boys. All three of them. And it was the reason why we also got into Karnataka and we're doing work there is because the delivery boy or who the delivery person, let's make it gender agnostic, has your phone number, has the time when you are at home, has your address, he can actually track you. That's how dangerous it can be. So we thought, we approached the Karnataka government and said, can we pitch in and, you know, train girls to do this? They were more than delighted, obviously. So we have another group of, we have a lot of girls there doing this job as well. So looking at this, Amazon got back to us and said that they would like to, do a deal with us. So they signed an MOU with us, with Amazon has signed an MOU with us. For us as a company, it's the mother of all deals, because they've signed a deal for 30% of all delivery people to be women, and that's 1 lakh women. So.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Proud of what you're doing. Okay. Riddhi, to you now. Why did you choose to build this? I mean, why Lajja? Why not anything else?
The seeds of Lajja was laid down while I was in first year of college. I wanted to start my academy to empower small children, making them understand what values are and how do you speak to your parents and how do you behave. And I had gone to my father if he could fund my business, the idea which I had in my mind. And the first thing what he told me is, do you feel for the concept? And I said, yes. And when I said yes, he said, earn the concept yourself. And that was a hit on me, because I was in the first year of college. I didn't know how to earn money, so I started with a dance class. But that I realized that we women tend to be dependent on people around for each and everything, right from funding to support to everything. And Lajja basically is not about talking entirely about empowerment, because it's the most chewed word going around, but Lajja is more on empowering women from within. So unless and until a woman is empowered from within, she understands what her concepts are, what her USPs are, she will not be able to take the things further. And I come across lots and lots of women in my daily routine and my daily life because of my training programs. And one day, 2 years back, I was taking a personal enhancement session with the director of a pharma company, and she's a lady. And while we were discussing on the first day about certain tests they had to undergo, and the lady told me that I would like to share my life journey with you. And the life journey she shared is that when I got married on the first day, the first night, so I wanted to understand how does it go on the first night. And my mother said, just do as what your husband tells you. And that certainly hit me hard. That why is a woman so dependent even for her sex life on the other person or the partner? Say, why can't she talk about her needs, her wants, her feelings to her partner? And that's where I decided to launch Lajja. So initially Lajja was more on a training program, 3 hours training program. We used to talk to women about the communication they need to do with your partners. It can be at the workplace, the communication at the workplace, the communication with your sex partner too. But eventually we saw that women are not coming forth to even understand or take their life ahead from there. So we started with different concepts eventually under Lajja. We started with coffee meets of 2 hours learning. And we said, okay, come and meet over a cup of coffee. Let's talk over coffee. And I started getting support from lots of achievers who are women, and they came forth and they started sharing their journey. So it was an indirect learning been given to. And that's how Lajja has been initiated.
Amazing. I mean, we have a strong culture wherein it's not good to use words which are not really social. And concepts like that, you cannot even talk about, include those words in your sentence. If you're using, you are probably a bad girl or bad human being. So moving from that paradigm to where she is now, it's a huge effort. How, as a community, are you moving this concept?
As a community, I'm getting lots of support from people who are already empowered from within, the women, I would say. And they are coming to support me immensely. So they have asked me to be tying up with them or their brands, whatever they have. And we are taking it further on a very large scale. From this year, 2017, lots of plans have been made. The first has been coffee meet. The second, what it is we have started... on a part of, we have launched an NGO under Lajja, wherein will be skills women who have taken a sabbatical from work. We would be upgrading their skills and we would be placing them at social sector. So we would be helping in this sector also. So this is how we are trying to build up a community. But yes, it's lots and lots of self-empowerment from within. You understand what, and you evolve around that.
I mean,
that's very important.
Since you mentioned your coffee meet, I saw Aparna in one of your coffee meets.
Right? Yes.
And she, Aparna, for your reference, Aparna is an author and she is also a CHRO to a large organization. She's a woman who speaks, who's very blunt and to the point. So I can understand the kind of discussion.
Yeah, so last coffee meet I had Aparna, and in fact, she has just extended all the support to Lajja. Mm-hmm. So I feel I'm blessed, and all the women with me too are blessed that way.
Amazing. Thank you, Riddhi. Neha. Yes, please. What made you start? Yes, she deserves that. Neha, what made you start UNIMO?
Okay, so she's saying UNIMO and it's mentioned UNIMO. First, I would like to throw a little light on what the acronym says. It's Universe of Moms. It started, in fact, much later before MUMO started, which is MUMO Mumbai Moms. In fact, that was a need of, I would say, I was a mother 2.5 years back of 7-year-old twin boys. And I'm a national training head as well. And when we were all mentioning about CHRO, that was the year I was chosen as the Young Learning Leader of India. And I wanted to party because, you know, it was a great achievement. And I called my husband and he said, no, I have an office party to attend. And it's a family day, so you have to come and join me there. We can celebrate on the weekend. And I said, okay, because that's important, right? And then I told my colleagues, you know, I won this. And they said, let's go out, have a coffee or a drink. That time, I would say registered in my head that women, especially after you become mothers, you don't really have, you somewhere lose your own identity. Of course, you are established business women. You're doing things around your kids or either around your husband or either around your social environment rather than doing things what you want to do. So why precisely mother, not women? Because mothers don't really get the break they deserve. Because somewhere subconsciously they're happy doing what they're doing. So if you have left your job and you're happy staying with your kid, it doesn't really get registered also in your mind that you have left somewhere your own identity to take care of your kid, because you don't want that guilt feeling to come and knock on your door. You're quite happy. And that was the best part, that the mothers never realized that they need a break. So I went online and I researched about mommy groups and mother connect groups, but I found a lot of information about baby or parenting groups rather than mother oriented groups. So when I say mother, it's not about kids. Of course, you become a mother when you're blessed with a little one. But then a mother is also a woman who's just a newfound mom. Okay. What exactly are we doing with these mothers? So there are mothers like, you know, Neha, who will come on the panel discussion with me and like to attend events like these. There are mothers in my group who are amazing dancers who want to just go back and, you know, relax and attend a dance or a DJ party. There are mothers who want to drive around social causes. Every woman sitting in here who's a mother wants to do something which somewhere she has forgotten, you know. So UNIMO was a concept of giving these mothers the well-deserved break. So the tagline of UNIMO or Mumbai Moms is "Ek break to banta hai." So basically we want mothers to come out only once a month and do things what they love to do. It must be a DJ party, it can be a theme party, it can be a masquerade, it can be a party with their husband. So, you know, discovering the V time again, which you have lost after becoming a mother. So that was the concept, and I suppose it's resonated quite well on Nabomita with everywhere. And last year, Sheryl Sandberg wrote about us as her favorite community on Facebook. And she said that this community is exactly doing the same thing I'm doing in US, which is, you know, giving mothers the well-deserved break. So, and she has written in Hindi that ek break to banta hai. So I suppose that says mothers worldwide are all the same. So, yeah.
Okay, you remind me of a quote by Sushmita Sen. She said that when she became a mother, her mom told her that the best gift that you can give your daughter is to live a normal life and show how it needs to be left, even though you're a mother now. So obviously, it's not just the break. I think I don't want to use the word entitlement, but it's until and unless you are normal, you're not showing your daughter how to be normal. I belong to a family wherein both my parents were working. They ran NGOs, they ran corporate business, and to me it's so natural, it's so normal. When she was talking about daycare, I was wondering, it's such an old concept. Why are people still?
In fact, why do you feel guilty about it? Nabomita, basically, we have had women, we don't do only virtual chatter on Facebook and WhatsApp. Of course, we are huge on Facebook and WhatsApp. But we believe, like, from the day one till now, like, we are 2.5-year-old community now, every month we do one grand meetup. And when I say grand meetup, in every city, there are 200 to 250 mothers whom we meet and do thing as per the theme we curate for them. Oh. So we have had moments wherein the mothers have left, like we did Bappathon. Bappathon was after Ganesha Visarjan. We did a beach cleaning drive where at 5 o'clock in morning had mothers come and clean the entire beach to understand the concept of eco Ganesha. So we don't give them gyan. We make them do things which they realize, because I feel the mother's definitely wearing pants today in the house. They are the ones who are the decision makers. That day when we were picking the pieces of Ganesha idol on the beach, there were mothers who left their 3-month-old, 6-month-old baby sleeping with the father to come and do this drive. And that was the moment they all realized and came back to me and said, Neha, let's drive the concept of Eco Ganesha. I said, that's exactly what we have to understand. Because now it'll get in-rooted in us. It'll never be like a gyan session we've attended and we are doing it. So I suppose mothers can make amazing, amazing, amazing difference to the economy and the society we are in today. Yeah.
Seriously, I mean, this is really inspiring. The concept of create, not just taking women for a workshop or giving them some me time in a spa or something, but I mean rooting them into a social cause and creating a business or rather a economy out of it. Thank you, Neha. To you, Baby Chakra and I.
So when you look at the entire ecosystem, right? When you look at young parents, anybody who is planning a baby. And you know, a mother who's had a new baby, she is quite flustered. The parents are quite flustered. They have millions of questions in their mind. They need a lot of support. They need, 70% of people are staying in nuclear families these days, and they don't have the traditional support system around them. And people want to make certain decisions themselves these days. Right, they want to make certain decisions for their children themselves, and there's so much of information and asymmetry around them. Is when we realized there was a huge opportunity to really create a care ecosystem for the kind of target population that we're looking at, which is the new age parent, the new age Indian parent, and that's where the genesis of Baby Chakra came about, where we want to be a trusted care companion, create that system of support by bringing together the services, the products, the experts right at their fingertips. So that's how Baby Chakra came about, and we knew right from the beginning where we had to create that trusted care companion. We had to connect with mothers, right? We had to initiate those conversations, those interactions, because we are dealing with a very sensitive set of people. And that's where the entire genesis of the community aspect to drive what Baby Chakra is today was seeded. We connected with mothers who believed in the journey that we were trying to create, and they believed in the idea. And what turned out was extremely beautiful, because they are the ones who are the evangelists now. They talk about Baby Chakra, they introduce more parents to Baby Chakra because they think that we're doing a great job out there. So that's in a bit about what Baby Chakra is all about.
With all these nuclear families coming up, the entire thing that is missing is the information. And the missing information, and if you can get it from a community who has not just experts, they also have, you also have your users sharing their experiences and information, right? And nothing like where your community members come and share the information, because that makes the new users adapt every information way too faster and way too smoothly. I mean, seamless integration.
Absolutely, because if we tell them, they probably will listen to us, but when mothers with similar experience would talk to them, they would identify themselves with what, you know, she's going through. So, absolutely.
Exactly. Thank you. So, with that, let's move on to the challenges part. So, can we start with you? What were the first few challenges? What are the first few challenges that you faced? And since you had already made a journey right now, what are the challenges now and how are you troubleshooting them?
Okay, so the challenges in 2007 when we started was, the first challenge was there were no women taxi drivers anyway. There were no commercial drivers. So, so leave aside the problem about no funds and all that. But the first issue was that we still don't have a Tesla here. So we would need a driver to drive a car, and more so a woman to drive a car, which was the very concept of women's safety. So we had to create, we had to, you know, do a lot of mobilization in the below poverty line girls, because the fortunate people who, everybody sitting here I'd consider very fortunate, they would have some education and something. So people from these kind of families where we are would not want to take up driving as a profession, even if it pays more. They would rather be in a BPO or a KPO, so, you know, it doesn't work for them. And that community and that level of people would obviously not know driving because they don't have a car in the house. I mean, they don't have a vehicle. So, if it dealing with a challenge where they're one very poor, they have a lot of dreams, but they never thought that they could become a driver. So, I had to first go and, you know, build my pool of girls who may come and take training with us to become drivers. So to do the first 10 girls, it took me 2 years. So 2 years for 10 girls it has taken me in 2007. But then one had to stick to that because I thought, let me become a driver. So I knew for sure that at least one cab would run, you know, I would drive. And then I had a couple of others who joined me. So it was great fun. Getting the cabs was a lesser challenge because I had some friends who decided to help me out with yellow number plate cars and those secondhand and, you know, whatever. It was horrible Indicas which used to make a lot of noise. But all the same, we had those cars. Very soon, very early during the journey of my first venture, which was Forshi, I got ILNFS and Oryx who came and, you know, gave me a lot of funding. The first mistake of an entrepreneur, to get enamored by large buildings and beautiful lobbies and, you know, swash offices and stuff. So anyway, I made my first mistake. So it's good to make mistakes early in life. So I sold a stake, which I would have never sold. You know, I sold 26% stake for a horribly small amount, but I made up later on for it because I took the value so high that they had to pay me 10 times the figure. So that was okay. The main challenge really was to get women to be trained and mentoring those families that they could become drivers. It took time, but I think we managed. And over 10 years now, I've trained about, 2,000 plus girls to become drivers. And I think we did Bombay, we did Delhi. I did, we did start in Delhi in 2008 as well, but we were a spectacular failure there. So, you know, we were lost leaders in Delhi and we quickly shut down because we realized that we couldn't operate Delhi. But over 8 years now, so the challenges are different now. 2016, I started Hey Deedee. So the challenge here was not money, was not women, because we cracked the code of mobilization and capacity building. We cracked the code on the investment. So also having been in the field for so many years, I think people start trusting you. So investment was not an issue. Today the challenge is that we need to get the girls out on the road much faster than 45 days, but I can't do that because the training, the license itself takes 30 days, so I have to wait for that. I have a huge waiting period for companies like Amazon, like Ecom Express, like Shadowfax, like McDonald's, anybody who tells me, give me 100 girls, give me 100 girls. Or where do I get 100 girls from? So I have a standing order of, I have a, if I can say, my order book, you know, if you call it an order book. I have an order book for 10,000 girls. But so that's my challenge today. So this is a good problem to have. You know, this is a good challenge to have. Money, not really a problem, because we work very closely with the government of Maharashtra and the government of Assam, Telangana and Karnataka. So we are a good, good validation is that working with the skill departments of the government, the biggest validation is when you get your first invoice paid, and we've got hundreds of invoices paid. So I think it's real. Skill India is real. The skilling departments in every state are very real. So anybody who wants to really do something with skilling, it's happening. It's really happening. And I am a standing proof for that, that it's the best time to be in this industry. So, you know, challenges are little compared to the benefits that we have now, at least as far as we are concerned.
I have a question. Yeah, that's an amazing
mic.
Okay. Last year, since I attended Women Part, you did share about a sudden business challenge that came to you because of a policy change. Remember? Yeah. Would you want to talk about it?
Yeah. Okay. So
attended? This is exactly how. This is exactly how it would happen. You are taking your business to a height. You have everything going, and suddenly there's a policy change, and everything comes to a halt overnight. So what do you do?
Yeah. That's okay. So it's interesting because. You know, to drive a yellow number plate vehicle, you need something called a commercial license. So anybody who, all of you drive here and you have a license which is called the non-transport license. It is called the NT license. So when I started in 2007, the rule was that to get a transport license, you have to hold a non-transport license for 1 year, okay, 12 months, and then you apply for a learning license transport, and after 1 month you get a permanent license transport. So the whole episode is 16 months. So I had appealed to the government that time to say that, look, I'm empowering poor girls and I'm empowering girls to get employment. Can we have a change in this policy, and can you just make a notification for, especially for us, to make it into 1 month? As luck would have it, they did it. I got it in 2007. So 2007 to 2015, we had a grand rocking episode, you know. And then what happened, you know, Uber had this unfortunate incident in Delhi, right, in December of 2014, when the girl got raped by a Uber driver. So everything was, you know, everybody was searching for Uber. There were no numbers, and they couldn't find an Uber representative. For 15 days, couldn't find an Uber representative. And the clam came, I think, that time, that people started thinking, how do they get their licenses? Suddenly, Uber came back to me on the 25th of December 2014. This happened on the 16th of December, and 25th of December, Uber called me and they said, can you join hands with us, and we want to deal with you. So we had an arrangement, and Uber mandated me to train 50,000 women drivers. That mandate is still live, and I'm supposed to train 50,000 women drivers for Uber. Now, Uber had a press conference on the 12th of March of 2016. And they said, here is this lady who's the master in this field. And so she will train women to become drivers. And so Uber is talking of women's safety, and we will induct women drivers. 16th of March, there came a notification in the government of Maharashtra to say that the 1 month period is going back to 1 year. I mean, people build business plans on it, you know, people invest money in this. How much money Uber must have invested even in having that press conference? It was a very, very, very special press conference they had. They mandated me, they gave me some money, you know, it was crazy. And I said, what's this? Suddenly, the whole rule has gone back. And it was a lobby. Obviously, there was nothing against me, but it was a lobby playing against Uber. There was a cab lobby which was playing against Uber. The tab cabs of the world, the Meru's of the world, everybody was there saying that how can you give them this permission? And so everything came to a standstill. Now, we are in 2017 today. I made an application again. It's still not come, but everybody has assured me that they're going to change the Motor Vehicles Act itself. And we're working on that. It's happening. And with the government, you have to be very patient. And, you know, so So the very fact that the Hey Didi came into existence, the two-wheeler rider concept came into existence was, I had a pool of 2,000 girls who had enrolled with me to learn cabs, to learn four-wheelers. I couldn't do anything with them for 1 year because the whole policy changed. So I said, chalo, let's get to work and I'll teach you two-wheelers. And let's get you into making, you know. So I think conversion of a challenge to an opportunity and a business model is what an entrepreneur has to really be open to. I couldn't see my girls sitting there and waiting for 1 year. What would I do with them? One, I would lose them. Two, I was sitting on a gold mine. I was sitting on a gold mine. I'm still sitting on a gold mine because there is, I have a 1 year, no, I have a 10-year heads up. For anybody who wants to enter this field, they have to come to me. They have no choice. Whether it's an Uber, whether it's an Ola, whether it's a government of Maharashtra, I believe Tata's is coming into it, Reliance is coming into it. So be it. If you want women drivers, you have to come to me. So I've built myself and I'm there. I mean, you know, I don't really care. So the challenge was converted to an opportunity and it's a good business to be in. And we make good money, so you know, in a sense that, yeah, it's a business. And you know, it's very strange that a lot of people do think, and I keep saying this to everybody, that I'm not an NGO, I'm a social entrepreneur, but I'm not an NGO. Good work can be done by people who are not NGOs as well. You know, with private companies, private people can also do good work. You don't have to be an NGO. You cannot. I call myself a professional beggar because I go begging for funds, not to the World Bank and not to anybody, but I go to investors. It's okay. I mean, we build value for them. How will they make money if they don't come to us? So it's good to be in this business.
So each time I hear this story, I like it even more. I'm sure next time I'm in a panel with her, I'll ask her the same question. No, I'm sure. It's too inspiring to be bored. Okay, Riddhi, to you, what are the challenges while building this community? And how are you troubleshooting it?
I had a list of challenges. First thing was that why did you name it Lajja? Because Lajja to them is more of a lady who is under Gungat and all that. So to make them understand that Lajja was named is, we are giving them a platform to evolve within, to understand their capabilities. Yeah. So the revolution that happens is where we are showing them from your shy nature to your confident lady is where Lajja comes. So that was the first thing which was often asked to me, why did you name Lajja? The biggest challenge I faced was convincing the woman to understand what your capabilities are. So I felt that if women had lots and lots of power and capabilities, but it was more on the latent end. So it took me time to make them understand that, okay, I'm not here to give any sort of training to you all, but I want you to realize that there's lots of from within. You already have been multitasking, you have been playing lots of role. Why do you challenge your own existence sometime? You know, why don't you come forth and express your needs, express your wants, express your feelings? That's exactly where I had to explain myself a lot, explain the concept. And we are just 2 years old. So we had I would not say, but there were lots of communities in the, like women communities. So we were often asked that what is different you're offering, you know? So it's every time explaining each and every person was a real challenge for us.
Thank you, Riddhi. To Neha, what are the challenges? I mean, you have already shared the unique concept. So we can understand uniqueness itself. Yes, absolutely.
So to give you a number, right now, UNIMO is touching around 160,000 mothers on Facebook and around 14,000 on WhatsApp. So you can understand, yeah, thank you for the applaud, but I wanted to come to the challenges part, that every woman there has a voice. And on social media, as you know, everybody speaks as per their interest area, as per their beliefs, as per their ecosystem. And you have to, you know, respect everyone's views and at the same time generate a content which will appeal to everybody.
Because, you know, launching a mommy community, it's free on a Facebook, you all can start a group. But how about sustaining it and making it interesting so that those people stay with you forever, okay? So basically what challenge I was facing, I was very clear from the day one when I started Mumbai Moms that I'll never have an India-wide group or a worldwide mommy community. It's very easy to have a lot of numbers added to your community, but you really lose the essence of that hyper-local approach. So for me, Nabomita, it was more of, you know, having only Mumbai as a center of attention, talk conversation which is around Mumbai so that the mothers of Mumbai can correlate with it. We were very strict about having only mothers of Mumbai enroll in it. But the concept went so viral that in like currently we have 9 chapters of different cities, again cities, and I would like to share this. Bhavesh told me to share it with you. 4 days back we have launched Gujmo. Gujmo is Gujarat Moms. You'll not believe, in 4 days we are touching 10,000 mothers in Gujarat, which is like amazing. And I have never seen this kind of growth anywhere. And when I say number, it's not number, it's also the quality, because when mothers put in their trust, and just to justify that trust becomes very challenging. You'll not believe, the only rule we have on the community is you have to do only positive conversations. We don't allow you bitching about your in-laws. We don't allow you, if you put in there and say my child has 102 degree fever, what to do? We tell her to go to a pediatric. Our mothers support that woman to give the pediatric's number rather than giving her domestic advices. We always tell them to go to a subject expert rather than discussing it on a social media and just making the content more interesting and more, you know, more apt for entertainment arena. We have got amazing psychologists, counselors, doctors, child psychiatrists, we have got NGOs, we have got police cell, we have got domestic violence people who all are there as on board as experts. So whenever we get a query like this, we divert that woman to that specific problem subject expert. So I feel somewhere mothers should do what they're good at, you know. And our events, one more thing, what we do, our events are always conducted by the mothers, of the mothers, for the mothers. So as I saw the gorgeous lady clicking pictures here, in all our events, so the photographers are mothers, the event managers are mothers, and not just women, only mothers, okay? The participants are mothers, the brand which supports us are mothers. So I suppose there it was really challenging to first identify these talents. Because at times there were free photographers who were giving me free opportunities, but they were guys. And I was very clear, I need mothers. And we never had a support system because, as she rightly said, Revathi, I'm also more of a social entrepreneur, supporting mothers to do things what they want to do. So no funds, so no money in the initial stage. We needed volunteers, and getting volunteers only mommies. But today it's like, I'll say again, I'm also sitting on a gold mine of mothers who are supporting us in every arena. We have a choice of pool of people who want to, you know, go ahead and give us some volunteering support. And they've been incredible women supporting each other. So I suppose we have somewhere changed the trend we were discussing in the earlier panel, that women support. It's a very different time, you know, women are supporting each other, and that's why it is such an amazing place to be now, yeah. It is. So, so Nabomita asked me outside also that the growth hacking concept. I don't know how many of you know about the concept called growth hacking. You know about the buzzword? Anyone here? Okay, so 2 women know about, the 3-4 women know about. So for the larger benefit, because aapke paas mic bhejna padega. So the growth hacking concept is a great buzzword in startup arena right now. Every time we get some buzzwords and we do discussions on it. Growth hacker is a very interesting concept. It's not a fad, I would say. Growth hacker is a little different from marketing. Like a lot of people, like today's startups, what are they looking into? They're looking into some lucrative funding to come in. And for that funding to come in, they have to prove themselves in that short span of time. So you need exponential growth, and that too in a very short span of time. How do you do that? The age-old marketing techniques won't work. So we don't need marketeers, we need growth hackers. So a lot of people like Alan Lewis and all have written some amazing definition of growth hacking, that a growth hacker is a person who helps you, you know, develop your customer base exponentially in a very short span of time. So it's a great launching point of a startup, but it might not really take you for a sustainable, you know, growth. You have to innovate your methods, do a lot of things to make sure that the growth hacking survives. But growth hackers do not really bother about budgets. They don't really think about, you know, pre-promotion, pro-promotion, a post-promotion effect. Growth hacking is when your true north is growth. You just focus on growth. And so if startups today are looking at hiring growth hackers, so today's panel, when we were discussing about growth hacking, I feel Mumo or UNIMO or, you know, mothers' communities like us are the growth hackers for a lot of brands. In fact, a lot of brands from PNG to a small mompreneur comes to us for that growth hacking support because we are inexpensive and we are there to help them in whatever way they need. Like startups like Urban Clap and all are married to us. We've launched them in Mumbai, you know, and they, I suppose, so the growth hacking is the in word, and if there are startups here, you should look into that. It's an amazing term. And yeah, we all are into the growth hacking. Like Revathi has done something very commendable. Though she's not just at the growth hacking level, she's much, much ahead of it. Yeah. She has agreed. Yeah.
Yeah. So over to you. What are the challenges?
So, you know, startups and, you know, in case there are any women out here who are running their own startups would know this. One of the challenges that we always face is, you know, deciding between whether to make the investor happy or really believe and drive what we really want to do. And that's the biggest challenge any woman entrepreneur will face today. And these are the discussions that we have in the boardroom, right? These are discussions that are just limited to the boardroom. Women don't come out and talk about them. And there's something we tell each other. We are like, we are building something which is extremely valuable and we have to stay true to it. We investor ka return dekhenge, ho jayega. You know, so that's one of the things that we always keep talking about. The other thing that I'd want to talk about is there will always be people who, you know, as Neha was saying, as Revathi and as Riddhi was saying, that they will believe in your journey. Take them along with you, collaborate. And there will always be people who would not believe in your journey. Over a period of time, you'd realize that they don't want to be with you, or they don't believe in your idea or what you're trying to build out. And some attrition in the community is totally fine. So, you know, and you know, the third thing is always think about how you're engaging and retaining your community. How are you giving them those tools and those ways in which they can grow and build themselves as well? So yeah, these are some of the challenges that you would always face. And I think a lot of people out here would identify with this.
Hello, yes, finally. Okay, thank God. To what she is saying, right, if you're building a community, especially a content-oriented community, to what she has, right, for you, what she was talking about was community capacity building. For you, it will be a rule that 90% of your users will only be there as silent users. It's just the 10% who would interact. Probably 8% would actually look for something, and 2% would contribute. So when you see a community measurement and you see all these matrices and you are disheartened, relax. That's exactly how every community works, be it Wikipedia, be it Quora, be it any other community. Those are the matrices. Those are the generic matrices on which it works. Obviously, if you are indulging some kind of a offline activity, which Lajja has or Neha has, then it goes different, because once you have live participation, the entire involvement with your community changes exponentially. So I had a great learning, but before we wrap this, takeaway. So what was your takeaway while building this community, Hey Didi?
I think as an entrepreneur, I would say a takeaway. Hey Didi is just one of the things that I have done, but I think if you're passionate about something, so for example, as far as I was concerned, I'm very passionate about driving. So I'm a rally driver. I've done about 85 rallies. I've won about 80 of them. And for me, I had to, you know, for me to do something with driving was, so for me to drive and make a living was the best thing that I could have thought of, you know, to drive a customer home and get paid for it. Wow, you know, it was amazing. So I think if you have the passion and you can dream about it, dreams are free, so one should dream, and I think you can make it, you know. I mean with a master's degree, I couldn't get a job that time. So I drove for a living and I brought up my children by driving around. So I think dream and have fun.
I mean, brilliant. Thank you so much. Dream, have fun, and then you
and
get...
make a living and build a value to your company. That's important, okay?
And, so. And then you get featured on Forbes and, as one of the trailblazers. Thank you. Riddhi.
The biggest takeaway from this community, what I've launched 2 years back, is I always feel, and I've, that's what I've been preaching to people, is for me, empowerment and confidence just like cousins. You know, both together always. So be empowered from within, and that's the thing which you cannot fake on. So start feeling it. Understand your capabilities, understand your own self, and start using the word that okay, you're empowered already.
So my takeaway, basically, it's not, I'm not a subject expert on it, but I would say what I believe into it. I believe into the magic of believing. I personally feel, though it's a cliche, but I always feel that if you really manifest something in your life, it happens. And I suppose all the people who are successful in here somewhere would have manifested that success much before you achieved it. And on that note, I would also say that, you know, there'll be dream stealers around you. There'll be people who'll always tell you why you should not do it. But if you have a scalable idea which you have tested and tried, go for it. In fact, it's very, you know, because I'm a mommy community, I'll say that whenever you are in dilemma whether you should get pregnant or not, it's the similar concept as whether you should launch your idea or not. And when you think about conceiving, conceive a child or an idea, and that would do it for you. So thank you.
You know, what we're building is very unique, right? We are, we realize that, you know, we have to marry, you know, consumer psychology with technology. And that's our power play, right? We have the recommendation engine, which is recommending relevant life stage specific, you know, step by step support to mothers. And you know, and that's where conversations start happening on BabyChakra. But what we also kept track of was that there has to be a face to those conversations. You have to interact with your users. You have to be, and that's what's wonderful about BabyChakra. That's what people come and tell us, that, you know, you're not an app. You are a face. You are a Neha Agarwal. You're a Naya Sagi, right? So that is what is happening, and that's something that every entrepreneur should always keep in mind. I think that humility should always be there. Two is, again, just for entrepreneurs out here, don't lose track of your data. Look at your data, right? And that's how you would track how, you know, your users are behaving. That's how you'll keep building and evolving your product the way that you are. And third is perseverance. Just believe in your idea and just go about it. And the world will conspire to make it happen for you.
Yeah, I'm audible. Thank you so much. Okay, one question with which we want to end. These days, we see a lot of gig economy jobs, right? Wherein women can take up any job and work from home and continue with it. They're getting paid. Few jobs are not good, but few jobs are really good. To them, as a company leader, as company builders, as building this economy, do you think years from now you will go ahead and hire a woman who had been taking these jobs serially, who had been into gig economy serially? Would you hire them for a leadership role in your company just as you're hiring a full-time person?
So I don't only believe it, but I've started doing it already. So first thing is, in my company, Rhyns Academy Private Limited, we have a team of 13 people working under the company. And for Lajja, I have a team of around 6 people working. And all are consultants. And they come for, like, the youngest one I have is a second year SYBCom girl who works with me for my concept. That's Lajja. Apart from that, I strongly believe in this system, and that's how I said that under Lajja we have started a new concept of giving out the skills people jobs that are as consultants but to social sectors, placing them at social sectors. So I guess, yes, that's a thing which every leader should be accepting as of now, or putting forth the things now.
You're building that. Thank you. Neha.
So gig economy is my favorite word, because I feel UNIMO is based on gig economy. The entire UNIMO universe of moms is only by mothers who are freelancers, who are working from home, who are mothers who are volunteering. Some are paid, some are unpaid, some trade barters with us. Like, for example, a photographer in our community is supported and promoted by all our mothers, and at the same time she's giving us her services free of cost. So everything is working on the age-old method of gig economy, wherein we are looking at part-time people, taking them on project basis. If we get a bigger brand, the person who's associated with it gets paid huge. If it's a small startup, we support them so that in turn they support us. So the gig economy is happening beautifully. Apart from that, there's one more vertical in MUMO and UNIMO which we support gig economy to. So people like, you know, there are a lot of consultants nowadays who are giving women, you know, jobs after a career break. So as you all know, these people have a lot of flexi job opportunities and all, and they were all coming to me because I had a pool of mothers with me. So we started a vertical called Her Turn to Earn. Now this is a very beautiful vertical wherein they have all enrolled with us. And there's it's again a very, we don't take even a single rupee from mothers in our community. There's no membership fee, there's no transaction fee, there's no promotion fee, nothing. So these are the mothers who list their resumes with us, and we put them to the right opportunities such that, you know, they are not lost in this world of fake jobs, lot of opportunities.
Exactly.
With us. So the gig economy is supported through these, again, SMEs, and they come to us and we just play the role of the mediators of bringing a talent to a gig economist. Yeah.
Brilliant.
So like that.
Brilliant. Neha, do you, Revathi.
I would also say that it's in fact a very good idea to adopt the gig consultants or gig economists, because you get lots of various talents under one roof. You have people who come from different background, and they get lots of, a pool of talents you can have, you know. And certainly at a longer span, it is more economical also.
Yes.
For your company. So, yes. It's worth going for it.
Yes, yes. Thank you.
So, Kima, Hey Didi, the whole concept of Hey Didi is, these are girls who come from below poverty line. I hope everybody knows what below poverty line is. It's an annual income of 1 lakh and less. So, when any girl starts working with us, the entire family gets pulled out of the below poverty line, because the girl starts earning 10,000 to 12,000 rupees a month. Now, how does she do that? So, every woman, you know, first of all, these are doing a very high risk job. Why do I call it high risk? Because it's on the road. Anything that you're driving on the road is a high risk job. So we train them, you know, 45 days to become riders. And after that, they have to cover a certain number of hours for their work. So whether it's a Magdi or a Pizza Hut or Subways or anybody, TBK or anybody who's, so there are dense hours of orders, lunchtime, dinner time. So I have completely given them the flexibility of working whenever they want to. And if they work for a full time of 8 to 9 hours, then they get paid a little extra money.
Wow.
We have about 128 girls right now on the road and 2,800 under training. So out of these 128 girls who are on the road, there are 65 of them who are actually housemaids. So we also, my whole project is about making sure that the girl has to own a scooter of her own. We facilitate that. She cannot buy it. So we work through various financial institutions where I've made it down payment zero, and they become my employees, and they start earning, and the money obviously goes from their salary. So they get about 10,000 rupees salary minimum. Now, I am neither a guarantor, I am not a co-applicant. I take no responsibility for the scooters except for the fact that I make sure that they get a job. They cannot get the loan of the scooter unless they have an offer letter from our company. So these housemaids are actually going to work on a scooter. What they used to do in 4 hours are now completing it in 1.5 hours, and they are on the road delivering parcels.
Lovely.
So we are the Uber of parcels. So, you know, I call myself the Uber of parcels. And so it's flexible. They can work as many number of hours. The highest grosser of the best girl for the month of February was 23,500. Just delivering parcels. She used to work from like 7 in the morning, and you know, she was doing, so I'm building an app. We are also getting tech savvy, so we're building an app where my app will be downloaded by anybody, B2C, B2B. They can just hire our girls and, you know, rest the girls. I'll have about 20,000 girls by December 2017. So that's in Bombay only.
Amazing, so. Amazing. Thank you. Neha, do you see gig economy transitioning into the full-time roles or leadership roles?
Absolutely. We have examples right there in our organization, right? So again, mothers who were part of our community saw what we are doing, and our content head, who is strategizing the entire content right now, and what you see out on BabyChakra is completely led by her. And she came in, she built out her team. She has a team of eight members right now, and she's just doling out the content in the most strategic manner. We have community managers again, who are mothers. They believed in what we're doing. They wanted to be with us. They wanted to be part of the journey, and they are working with us. So I think it's about really making people, one, realize that they have potential, so many more responsibilities, they don't know how to break out of it, and that's where responsibility of organizations and, you know, communities like us lies. So yeah, totally brilliant. Up for it.
Brilliant, thank you so much. I had a great time learning about how to manage a community, how to build a community. Thank you so much. I would want to end this with a message. This is a campaign called hashtag we are equal. We are equal. This campaign is being run by Ministry of Women and Child Development just to promote equality and all these gender biases that we have. All you have to do is, there's a whiteboard which is kept with Meenal. When you were signing in, you must have met Meenal. She has that board which has written we are equal. Take a picture, add your message to it, and tweet it with the hashtag to the ministry's handle, which is at Ministry WCD. And we are collating all these messages. Why we are requesting you is because whenever we have these campaigns by the ministry team, generally it's the top league of people, such as Mr. Amitabh Bachchan, who tweeted this time, who are taking such messages ahead. But we believe at our level we are making a difference. So really looking forward to see your message on Twitter. If you're not on Twitter, on Facebook, please put your picture in Facebook and tag the ministry's handle, Ministry of Women and Child Development handle in Facebook as well. If you can add me, I'm on Twitter, I'm Nabomita_smile. I'll retweet you. I'll make sure your message gets delivered well. So thank you so much for your support. I really thank Mentorpreneur for supporting this campaign. And thanks a lot.